All right, today we are going to talk about standalone applications in Liferay. And I would like to explain what this concept is and how this is going to change the way you code in Liferay. Liferay, we have heard, isn't so sexy. So do believe what we really think it's sexy. Sexy, we think, is jellyfishes. And the reason we think that is because they are the most amazing animal in the world. They are very efficient. And the reason for that is because they use jet propulsion to move, like jets. Scientists try to copy this mathematically, but it's pretty much impossible. So it's impressive. They are beautiful, and they are the only animal that has 360 degrees of view. And how they do that? They can do that because they have 24 eyes and 4 parallel brains. And this is amazing. I mean, jellyfishes are very powerful. And most impressive, they are immortal. A lot of people have tried to kill them. You can see this video to double check. And if you don't believe me, you can go to Japan. There is a sample in this museum. You don't need to hurry, they will be there forever. But they are the mostly dead creature on Earth. Be very careful when you see a jellyfish. And those big guys, last month and a few years ago, they shut down 5 different nuclear power plants. One in Sweden, another in Japan. They are taking over everywhere. And this is impressive. How they do that? How jellyfishes are so smart, taking out nuclear power plants, having all these superpowers. What's the secret behind them? How can they do that? And this applies to software. Jellyfishes are not a single animal. They are one animal made by very small organisms, very specialized. Each part can work together with another part, and they are very powerful. And this is how they can be immortal. If they lost some part, they can create a new jellyfish from that piece because they can combine other different microorganisms. And teams with a better distribution of skills, not segmented by roles, they have better results. And when we have a software company, we usually split back-end development and front-end development. You have to wait one to be ready, and then you move the software to the next step of the production. And this is not good. Why can't you parallelize work? Why can't your designers and front-ends work at the same time the back-end is modeling the back-end? Why cannot do it? And we want to change that in Liferay, because Liferay is like that. Liferay, you can serialize teams. You can have different segmented roles. And we want to change this in Liferay 7. And that's the reason why we created this project, standalone applications. There is nothing new in terms of following trends. What we did was combining a lot of different techniques that you can use to build your software. Back in 2013, we were in Madrid in an engineering treat, and Ray Ojeda, I'm sure a lot of people know him, he was telling me, I want to build my brother's website in Liferay, but I just have a weekend. And I said, oh yeah, I also want to build my small open source project's website in Liferay. Why can't we do that in a weekend? Because we don't have enough back-end developers. We don't have infrastructure to deploy very quickly Liferay. We need to have this. But I said, why can't we change that? And then we added to the roadmap this planning to think, how can we improve Liferay to be able to add those new layers for you? We want to make Liferay our jellyfish. We want to make Liferay to be very modularized. And you can see that already in the back end with OSGI. And we are trying to also bring that to other layers of Liferay, like storage and front end. App is becoming very popular. If you forecast app versus web, in 2013, app passed it. What's going to happen in 5 years with the internet? What's going to happen to the web in 5 years? Taco Bell is a very big American Mexican food franchise. And recently, they announced they are going to shut down their website. They are going to keep only the app. What is going to happen in 10 years or 5 years from now? I don't know. But I want to be watching them. That's why we want to invest in this project. If you want to build an Android app, if you want to build an OS X app, even Angular, Ember, Sena.js, whatever, if you want to build an app in Liferay right now, you have to deal with all the current front-end layers we have, JSPs, FreeMarker, Velocity, all that. Why not just start an empty folder, create your HTML, and deploy it to the cloud or deploy it to a Liferay instance? That's what we want. Let's say currently you have this possibility. You have multiple devices that you want to create this very nice app. You want to make those apps to talk to each other. And what do? When you want some cloud to handle that for you. You set up your cloud, you deploy Liferay to there, and you talk to this cloud using web services, using JSON web services. Most of you already have played with it. But this is not enough. I only have HTTP layer to talk to my data store, my database. What if I need more? What if my app gets very big? I smash in success and I need to scale, I need to grow. What can we do? We fail. We have to hire backends, we have to create different teams, we have to do a lot of changes in our company in order to do that. And with standalone applications, this is going to be simpler. We created a bunch of little models like the jellyfishes for you. One of them is data store. Many of you may ask why they created a data store layer. Why do you want that? We already have service builders, we already have relational databases. Why do we need a new data store layer? This is because we want your app to be most powerful to modern applications. In modern applications, your app can scale. And we want that to be schemaless. We want to support NoSQL as well, out of the box in Liferay, as an extra feature for you. And this needs to be scalable and very robust. Because imagine this situation. Imagine you have an application A that wants to send a message to B, but B is offline. What should you do? You have to write some Java code to handle this logic, to persist the data. When the client gets online, you send the message to user B. But I need to deploy, I need to have Java, I need to send all that to Liferay. But forget that. You have another option now. And this option is because in standalone application, besides the data store layer, we are going to give you a bunch of API clients. And those API clients support cross-domain requests. They are based on promises. They handle errors for you. They can talk to the data store in real time. And we are also providing this RESTful layer on top of this data store. And these API clients can talk directly to those RESTful layers in real time. The RESTful layer can access the data store. I know it's getting complicated, but it's really simple. You guys will see it. And then after you do that, you have API clients that are completely standalone. You can run inside your iOS. You can run in a simple HTML website without Liferay, even in your computer. You access everything in real time. And how this real time works, how this RESTful API works, it's very simple. This client is a standalone JavaScript. It has only 8 kilobytes of JavaScript. No dependency in jQuery, no dependency in YY or Alloy. You just include in your app with a very cheap price, and it gives you real time and ability to request. And how this API looks? Just a little of code for you. Imagine you created this users entity on your data store. You can request this URL, and then you have the fluid interface of promises to handle your requests. So you can say, then you can catch errors very easily, and this is all available, and it's more robust for you to grow your app without having callbacks, nested callbacks inside things like this. It's more fluid for you, and this is available. We want to make you able to talk to Liferay directly without having to deploy server-side code. If you want, you can. But if you don't, if you want to build modern apps, faster apps, we have those clients. And we have plans to have them also, like you saw, in Java, Objective-C, and whatever language is needed. It's an evolution of our mobile SDK. To understand a little bit what this RESTful API is and why are you guys adding this, you guys have already the JSON APIs. You have URLs to invoke Java methods. Why do you want to add a RESTful layer? Yeah, I want to add because I'm human. And to talk to machines is first easy if we speak some easy idiom. And RESTful is a very easy contract. JSON RPC is invoking methods from my HTTP layer. I have to know the parameters. I have to know the contract any developer create. I don't know what they thought when they create that. In REST, I don't need to study. It's just always like that. And this is more semantic. W3C is investing a lot in this specification. And you can also use HTTP methods to communicate to the same URL. So what that means, HTTP methods, for who doesn't know it, is like when you get a URL, you have the get HTTP method to inform you want that content. You have post are the two most popular ones. But you also have others. You have delete, you have patch, you have put, you have other verbs that you can take advantage to the same URL. You don't need to change the URL to change the action. How that works. Let's say again, our users entity that we created in our data store, we can use the client's API to create this users entity. Automatically, you gain this URL. Very nice. Your RESTful services are scoped by version. This means you can grow your services. You can have different versions of your API, like GitHub, like Facebook, like those services. You can have this as well in Liferay. And then the user's very friendly name URL is created for you. That's all you need to remember, this URL. Another thing we wanted to do is, when you have distributed databases, it's not very simple to create IDs for your entity. Of course, you can use your username in the URL, but we need to support IDs. And IDs in distributed system are complicated. We needed at least our URLs to look like this, which is a little better, but let's understand why we need to have these complicated IDs. In a regular database, it's very easy to give an ID to an app. The app can request, give me one ID, and you can auto-increment a database field. But in a NoSQL big data environment, it's much more complicated. Each database you have can give different IDs to your app. And they can be not random, they can be duplicated, they can be unordered, and sometimes you want to have ordered IDs. And think about this. Imagine I say you have different machines running a server, and I need to request IDs for them. Those IDs need to be random. They need to be ordered by time. They need to be unique. And they need to support this distribution between my data centers. And I also want them to be human readable. We start to face these kind of problems when we start this project that we never had before. And that's why we implemented this solution. I'm not going to go too deep in this, but we implemented this algorithm, which is able to give you distributed, ordered IDs for your application. And if you want to have nice IDs like this, you just call a method, and we give you one that we guarantee that is not going to conflict. Of course, if it's random, it has a chance to conflict. Otherwise, it could not be rendered. But the chances are very small. If your app grows too much, you can go to a different ID provider. And that's how I want to do. You guys see I have now a nice URL and I have a nice ID. How come I save data? How come I can update an entity I have? And that's very simple. This is one example of a request updating a user. If you want to creating a user. If you want to create a user, you just need to request using jQuery, using the browser, any library you want. You just need to request a post or a put to this URL that you memorized. And then you can specify the serialized document here. And remember, it is schemaless. I don't care what you put here. Just store it. Some people may ask, why you are so flexible? Why are you allowing me to have a schemaless database? And then my answer is, this is how web is now. This is how the new young guys are doing. They don't care about data structure. They don't care about that. And in reality, they can do a lot of things of this. If you need something more well structured, you can go to the service builder way. You can have both. If you want to update, what should you do? You change the URL? No. You keep the same URL, just specify the ID for the user, and you set a put or a patch method. It's just changing the HTTP method, and that's it. You update the user you have. And you can do from your browser. It's very easy. And notice this. I will go back one slide. When you want to put this user, I answer for you 202 in HTTP, so I accept that you are authenticated. And then I say created 201 status. So my HTTP headers start talking to you in a friendly and human way. You don't need to guess what's going on. When you update, the same. We accept, and then we said OK. When you delete, you just need to change that as well. And we say 204, no content. It's very easy. OK, so let's get those values now. I added, I updated, so how can I read those? You can also request to this URL a get. And then automatically, Liferay serializes this document to JSON and gives you a JSON like that. And it's nice because why should you create a controller just to convert a JSON to an XML? You don't need that. You can specify multiple output formats here. If you change to XML, it converts to XML for you. And you can plug more converters if you want. And what if I need other actions? What if I don't want only add, put, delete? My app is much more complex than that. OK, if they are, you are also able to create custom verbs. You can create your verbs that are exposed through this HTTP layer. And this is all available for you, auto-generated. And think about that. Before, in order to have an entity in Liferay, I have to create a service XML, I have to deploy this to a server, I need to wait to be deployed sometimes, I need to restart my server, and now this is all live, auto-generated for you, and you can create entities from your console of the browser. You can open Chrome if you are authenticated, you can say new users, and then you create in real time. It's a big change. What is this real time you are talking about? And this real time is what is, in my opinion, very attractive for modern apps. When you use Gmail, when you use Google+, you can feel there is something different. It's faster. They pull data for you. How they do it? I want those API clients to be able to talk to these RESTful web services layer in real time. And this is not an easy thing to do. We asked Igor and other guys from the API team to help us with this. And this is not very straightforward to support WebSockets in all the application servers that Liferay supports. And we are trying to fix that problem. But our idea is to have this talking in real time to the RESTful layer. And you can build apps like this. Check this out. How cool is this? You can create a chat that runs in different browsers. These are two different browsers. While I type here, the other users receive the notification. When I press enter, it's persisted. It's pushed to everyone, like a push notifications in Android. How many lines of code do you think you need to write this with these new client APIs? 100? 10? Just a few. You can not only request, but you can subscribe to a service. When you subscribe to a service, you can receive notifications when things happened. So you can listen your database, you can listen your server, the same way you listen DOM nodes in the browser. You subscribe to an entity or a topic or a custom verb that you create, and data comes once you have it. And that's all. You can build a chat with three lines of code. You have push notifications for free. And we want to improve this layer to also support push notifications for native apps like iOS and Android. So with the same API, you will be able to have push notifications for all your devices. One other problem that we tried to solve, and we did, which I like as well, is routing. When you want to build a hot site in Liferay, and you want to build two different campaigns, I need very nice URLs. It's marketing. I don't need very long parameterized URLs. I need a nice special woman URL that shows the offer for girls. And I need another one to show offers for boys. And in Liferay right now, you can use friendly URLs to do that. But it's not that easy because you have to scope for the site. You still have some extra information in the URL. And I just need that URL to be like this. In standalone applications, we give you the full power to control your routes, and it's very easy and very powerful. We can, through a TXT file, you can map all your routes. And look how this works. You specify the HTTP method here, and you specify any URL. And then you can map this to a qualified name of any action controller. So actions.offerAction is a Java class in this package and has a method called woman and has a method called man. And this is a very simple Pojo class that if you return a string, it outputs for you. And imagine this. Besides the auto-generated RESTful services, we are giving to you the ability to create the contracts of your app on a TXT file. And you can go more. You can use your creativity to go more. If you start to map in other actions, like delete, put, you can create GitHub APIs, kind of, Facebook APIs, or your app APIs from this file. You don't need to expect that to be all the ones generated by our data store and the RESTful services. This is very powerful. And then on Citizen, you have this controller. But you can ask, how can I access from a Pojo class a Java Liferay service? You can. OSGI is going to give you this power. We are going to have something that injects services on your Java class. So if you want, you can still access user local services. You can still access groups, anything you have in the current Liferay. OK, we have data store, we have RESTful layers, we have API clients, we have routing system. But you took out of the UI from me. You said I can create an empty folder and start an application. I have all that. It's good. But what about control panel? What about sites? What about all that? Well, you don't have. You can create from scratch your UI. You can use frameworks like Polymer, Polymer Elements, or Angular, or Alloy UI, or anything to build your UI. And what we want is to create a new ecosystem of small apps, and those apps can be dependent on other apps. So then we can start creating smaller and smaller modularized apps, and those apps can be installed on your portal version. And then you can start to build Liferay the way you want. And those microservices are going to be available for you. And that's why we created these automated tools. And automated tools are optional. You don't need to use them if you don't want. But what is this? We collect all the modern web practices for development, like Coop, Yeoman, which is a generator for code, Gradle for people who likes Java and still wants to build app in Java. So we collect all that, and we created custom tasks for you. And those custom tasks, you can, from Gradle, build your Java, Pojo classes, or whatever you have in that, and we invoke Goop behind. And you also can access direct from Goop. And what those Goop tasks gives to you is a set of reusable functionality, like static generators. They minify your JavaScript, they gzip your JavaScript, they minify your HTML, they optimize your images, they can parse templates, they can do all that for you. And if you don't want to use, if you have your own team with own practice, go ahead and do your way. And then in the end, you can have flavors. When you build your app, you can set up a different flavors, like mobile or desktop. And from the same source code, you can have multiple folders, one for mobile, another for web, another for Retina display. And when you build them, you can build all at the same time. And with one development, with one effort, you have UIs deployable for multiple devices with all the freedom, without having to delete what we provide in the current JSPs. And most exciting for developers, what about tests? This is something that is going to change. You can, from those automated tools also, create your functional tests. And those functional tests can run in server farms, like browser stack or any other. And you can, from the command line, you can run those tests with tests your views without Liferay in real browsers. This is a big change for the way we develop UI. And we believe this will change the quality of our UI and the quality of our apps. After we finish all that, we want to collect all those little pieces and make it available in Liferay. So we are going to have portlets for you that manage quota, manage billing, security policies, and create reports for, let's say, your user's entity. And this is available at one click in Liferay. So imagine this. Google App Engine has an engine on the cloud that we can deploy apps to there. In Liferay, we are giving you the power to have your own app engine on your company. So it's big. You can have this powerful on your servers and everything. We have plans in the future to start sell that as a cloud services as well, if you don't want to have the headache of setuping for you. But if you want, we are giving you that. The architecture is a little tricky. I'm not going to go too deep. But the current Liferay is like this, very simplified version. We have JSON Web Services here. And the blue box is the front end. Realize that we currently have the front end hidden behind the services. And this is a little weird, but that's how it was in the past, how it is in Java. And the apps that you want to do outside this front-end layer, it talks to the JSON talks to service builder talks to database. That's how it works, okay? How it's going to be? This is going to still exist, and standalone apps are going to add new models. How those new models works? Works like this. Now you have front-ends that are first citizens. They can run separated completely from Liferay because of the API clients. And they can be Java and whatever. Those can talk to the RESTful web services. And the RESTful web services can talk to the data store. And in this data store, we are going to provide you multiple implementations, like MongoDB, Elasticsearch, whatever. Or you don't need to care. I just use the default version. And the data store will take care of this. After this is done, your decoupled front ends are going to talk in real time to these RESTful web services. And these RESTful web services will talk to the REST. Besides, we give you the random ID generator. We will give you a way to create OAuth 2 or any kind of authentication for your services. So you can say, this group of users access this URL. Those group of users access that other URL. So you have this granularity. And we are going to have as well some sort of permission UI for all that. comparing side by side, sorry for this slide, it's too much information, but if you want to check online later, is basically we had that and they are still there. They are still available for you, you can use, but now you have all those new little pieces here. Okay, so we are adding more things for you. So standalone NAP is a lot more than just a new JavaScript framework and a new layer for you. It's a bunch of changes in the concept we build software on Liferay that's going to change us and change your company to the future. And you could be asking, why do I need that in my company, right? You saw apps are growing, app environment. Everything is changing, everything is modernizing. And we are not following trends. We are making all that available for your company. We want to modernize web development into your business. We want to make this a very normal part of your life. When you are not growing, you are dying. And we are trying to avoid that on your company, in our company. We stopped thinking a little bit concrete, as engineers think, as mathematicians think, and we think a little bit abstract. That way, we could go very far, think about crazy ideas, and try to go back with concrete implementations. That's what we are trying to do here. We don't want to be just sexy. We want to be more. And data store is our jellyfish. Oh, sorry. Standalone apps is our jellyfish. We are connecting all these pieces because we want to be more than sexy. That's all, guys. Thank you.